A very warm welcome to all of you to the seventh session of the NatHealth Leadership Reach Out series. This is a special initiative where experts, leaders, and medical practitioners with varied experiences in the healthcare industry can engage with frontline health warriors to understand concerns, challenges, offer advice, mentorship, counseling, and any other required support to motivate them and express solidarity. As we all know, the COVID-19 pandemic has overburdened our health system and has also impacted the mental health of healthcare professionals, especially the frontline healthcare workers who are at the forefront saving thousands of lives every day. Testing has been traditionally been a big challenge in India due to lack of awareness and access to screening services. COVID has served that as a wake-up call to focus more on diagnostics, as detection is the first step towards cure of any disease. Pathology, x-rays, ultrasound are the cornerstones of healthcare screening systems, and these are critical for both maternal, child health, diabetes, anti and postnatal checkups, as well as communicable diseases. However, even for conducting simple blood tests, x-rays, ultrasound, there is a serious shortfall of trained and specialized manpower. Telemedicine today can be harnessed for improving the diagnostic scenario because of the limited number of qualified technicians. It's important, therefore, to monitor patients with non-communicable or chronic ailments regularly, if not possibly physically, then remotely. Therefore, to address the huge scarcity of these specialists in our country, there's a need to develop a unified framework and increase investments in the areas of skilling, training, and medical education of allied health professionals to give a boost to the diagnostic sector. It is my privilege today to moderate this session on behalf of NatHealth, Healthcare Federation of India. We're pleased to have Ms. Samira Shah, Secretary of NatHealth and Managing Director for Metropolis as the speaker today. Samira is the promoter and Managing Director of Metropolis Healthcare Limited, a leading chain of pathology labs and large network in India and Africa. A finance graduate from the University of Texas, Samira is also an alumni of the Harvard Business School. For the last 20 years, she has built Metropolis a leading electronic chain of laboratories with a wide network of close to 3,000 laboratories and patients. Under leadership, Metropolis had a successful listing on the stock exchange in April 2019, and she has played an instrumental role in changing the pathology industry landscape in this country from just being a doctor-led practice to a professional-led industry in an extremely unregulated, competitive, and fragmented market. Amira has been named amongst the most powerful women in business by Fortune India for 4 years running, by Business Today for in 18 and 19. Recently, Amira was also the Entrepreneur of the Award by EY in the healthcare and science category. She also launched the Empower It in October 2017, which is a peer-to-peer mentoring and networking ecosystem for women entrepreneurs. Amira, warm welcome to you. Today, we look forward to your guidance and advice to our frontline health workers.
Happy to be here.
Okay, so we already have some questions which have come in over the last couple of days from some of our healthcare workers. So let me kick off with the first one. The diagnostic industry has been as strained as the hospitals, right? And as you know, how have you, as running Metropolis, managed to keep the motivation of your staff at an all-time high?
You know, I think when all of us were grappling with the crisis and what it meant for us personally, obviously we had to think about what it meant for our industry. And at the same time, suddenly find a way to ramp up and take care of people's needs for COVID testing. This was last year, March actually, and end of March. And I remember the one of the few thoughts that all of us had in mind is, look, how are we going to survive? Do we even have cash, right, to manage? Because business was down 90%. And I remember talking to my team and we said that, look, the biggest focus has to be our team, because we're asking them to really be at the front, go and take, collect samples, do the tests. And nobody knew anything about Corona. I mean, today, whatever discomfort we feel, it was 100x of that last year. We didn't know how it spread, nothing. So I think motivating the team, we had to do three things, right? Number one was very tangibly show the team that we had their back, that it wasn't just about giving speeches and encouraging them to go, but to say that, look, if something happened to you, what are we going to do to take care of you? So we created an employee fund that said that, look, if anybody gets sick, all your hospitalization, medical bills, everything will be taken care of by us. If you spread it to your family, same story. If, God forbid, somebody dies, there is a life insurance plan created for them. you know, we created we rented out hotels close to our labs so that we could put people in the hotel so they don't have to take that potential infection back home and infect their family members. We hired buses just to take them from home and bring them so they didn't have to go in public transport, and public transport was even shutting down. So there was just a bunch of things that we did that they tangibly gave them the sense that, look, we have you, you know, you don't have to worry about. Number two, it was about the compensation that was going to be given to them that made it worth their while. So we actually chose to pay people more. We gave them, you know, in some cases, bonuses, higher compensations. We paid them more per visit. At the end of 6 months, which was April to September, I actually took my entire comp and sort of gave it as awards to all our frontline workers. So there were just a lot of things that we did along the way, besides the speeches and the encouragement and all of that, and the connect, that gave them the feeling that, look, you know, they're not going to be alone.
That's fabulous. I mean, giving higher pay and covering life insurance, that goes a long way, I think, in motivating people. Tell me, while in your work, there is a whole fear was there a fear for your employees to go and do home collection from COVID positive patients? And was there a separate approach for those people that you took? Because they were directly in line, more in line than those who were in
the. No, absolutely. So some of the initiatives I'm talking about were for everybody, but the things like the extra compensation, the things like the, were very much for the frontline workers who were actually in some way coming in contact either with a COVID or non-COVID patient. Because see, again, you can't say only COVID, because what about the guys who are doing collection of non-COVID, but they don't know they're COVID. Right. So anybody who was on the front line, whether it was a logistics boy, a scientific representative, somebody who was, talking to patients, meeting, going home, or people who were dealing with samples, the testing, the pathologists. I mean, all of them across the board were some of these initiatives.
How was lost? Because long working hours was also a constant feature for everybody at this time, at least for diagnostic centers and hospitals. How would you handle employee fatigue and burnout? Did you hire a lot of more people, or did you just have to motivate more people, the existing people?
No, we had to hire more people because, at the end of the day, the COVID volumes, come in surges, right? So it suddenly is there for 3-4 weeks and then it's gone for again a few months. And then if you make the mistake of letting go of those people, you basically don't have trained people for the next surge, right? So it's about, taking a bet on where things are going in the country in terms of COVID infections and having a clear viewpoint about not fooling yourself into believing that it's all gone and over, and therefore building infrastructure accordingly. But we had to hire new people. We hired a few hundred people very quickly on the ground. And that was one of the big things that we had to do, besides obviously getting all our existing people to really stretch.
That's interesting. So you hired more people. Did you find skilling or challenge, or are you upskilling people yourself?
A huge challenge. I mean, in our industry, across healthcare, you get young, fresh graduates, but they're taught theoretically in their colleges and their medical institutions. And by the time they actually come in, I'm talking about non-COVID times, by the time they actually come in, and like in a pre-COVID era, we would bring in a pathologist or we would bring in a technician. The technician would work and train with us for at least a month before we would put them on a job. With pathologists, they would usually be training for at least 6 months before you actually allow them to sign reports. And here we didn't have a chance to do those things, right? You just had to, you had to very quickly train in a matter of a few days and put them on the job. So it was also very, very scary and troubling, I think, for healthcare institutions. And I know this to be true for all healthcare institutions, where our own levels of standards of excellence in terms of the kind of training we would like to do, the kind of things we would like to do, everybody had to, I wouldn't say take shortcuts, but everybody had to, be flexible about those things while being sure about the quality we were offering, but be flexible about our normal protocols, because this is not a normal time. We had to work very differently and innovatively to make sure that we were able to just bring trained people in, even though we didn't have, unfortunately, the luxury of time to train them in our way.
That's true. Tell me, just moving away from to patients, patients are also very anxious, right? They were relentlessly following up with reports because naturally there was an overload and reports were delayed. Patients were rude. So it must have taken a toll on your people, right? I mean, have you experienced something like this, and how did you manage that surge? That patient call out, really.
So, you know, there is a management philosophy in hospitality that says that how you treat your employees is how your employees are going to treat your customers. And in healthcare, that's actually very, very true, because if you don't have a caring and empathetic attitude towards your employees, you cannot expect them to do the same towards your customers, right? And this was that one example where we knew our poor employees were putting their lives at risk, were working like crazy hours, 18 hours, not going home, not seeing their families, were getting beaten black and blue by customers, because everybody had high expectations, high anxiety, and the easiest place to take it out was on the healthcare institutions. And we had to really treat our employees with kids gloves, to just make sure that they were not feeling sandwiched with pressure. Because it's one thing you get pressure from customers, but then if you get that kind of pressure from your own management and your own supervisors, there's no place to go. So, I mean, honestly, they did a great job in absorbing that pressure, but we also had to do the jobs of being the valve that helped release it. And had that had to be done by doing connect programs, which were non-COVID, whether it was, a smaller, lunch in the office, or whether it was, suddenly a Mithai day, or, just something to break the ice and the tension of what everybody was feeling on a minute-by-minute basis. So it was very, very challenging. And I think, honestly, the emotional burnout for healthcare workers has been even more significant than the physical burnout. Because, just being talked badly to all the time, like you don't care, being told that you haven't done something fast enough. I mean, people work in healthcare because they care. That's the last thing you can blame them for. But the situation was such.
Fair enough. What were the lessons, you think, from the first wave, which we didn't take into consideration, the second wave just led to the tsunami of cases, including beds. And what are your views on what should we prepare better for the future?
Nitin, you're breaking in and out. If you could come a little closer, that'll be helpful.
Sorry. What I'm saying is, what were the lessons from the first wave that we did not take into consideration in the second wave, right? And what should we take, and how should we prepare for the future? What should we take into account for the third proposed wave?
I mean, I think first thing is honestly to face reality, right? I mean, even post the first wave, we congratulated ourselves and told the whole world about how we had somehow managed to escape COVID and the fatalities of it, because what? And we came, every part of the world, and we came up with 20,000 reasons on why Indians were special. I mean, let's be realistic about it. We are humans like everybody else, and we can fall prey to the same infection. So I think first is to face reality, to say that, Corona is not going anywhere. It's very much here to stay. And I was actually very surprised recently. I mean, I've been one of the biggest proponents from last year. I remember I told friends, family, in speeches how Corona was going to go on for minimum of a year to 2 years at the time. And this is when the lockdowns were happening for 15 days at a time, and everybody thought I was cuckoo and being absolutely cynical about it and really pessimistic. And even today, I was thinking, okay, maybe for the next 2-3 years, we'll continue to see this kind of an intensity of waves coming, and vaccination will of course start. It will take its time to roll out. But I think the next couple of years, India is going to have a tough time. I read an article from a very well-known source that talked about how it's going to take 10 years for Corona to become like the flu, which basically means that we can get the infection, sit at home and not worry about it. As we know, the flu still has fatalities, not that it doesn't. But it's a lesser fatality, which is why it's less of an issue, and we've understood the influenza better. But it's going to take 10 years for that situation to normalize. That to me came as a shock. I was expecting a few years, but 10 I wasn't expecting, right? So I think it's about, one, facing reality. It's about preparing our infrastructure, reacting in the right way economically and through public health experts, not politically, in terms of our regulation. It's very, very important that these decisions are made by experts in public health and in private healthcare who can come together and actually talk about what's happening. For example, one of the things that we've been urging the government is saying that, look, private sector and public sector should have a far deeper partnership during this time. Because as private sector is running 70% of your requirements in the country, often we get data points that public sector may or may not have because they also have so many other things to look after. I'll give you a simple example. In the first 5 days of February, I knew we were having a second wave, right? Because with our 200 locality presence across the country, I could see the numbers inching up, right? Across. So you know you're coming for a second wave. Now, if we have the platforms to have that kind of close dialogue between private and public, we had a good 45 days before we hit a peak, even in Maharashtra, right? So we had time to prepare, even if not before. So I think closer conversation, closer dialogue, discussing mathematical models about where it's going and building infrastructure accordingly is absolutely the need for the hour. You know, I was sharing with you just before we spoke, I mean, if we're expecting children to get infected in the third wave between September and November, has somebody checked, do we have enough pediatric ventilators, right? These machines are different than they are for adults. Make a list of all the things that are needed, right? Calibrate your opening of the economy very carefully, not like the last time where it was done sort of full on opening, but if we do it in a calibrated manner, we prepare ourselves infrastructurally, we have regular communication and dialogue between private and public, we can manage this. We can't beat it, we can manage it much better than we managed it before.
You know, you spoke about children and they've been conflicting reports about whether the next wave will impact children or not. Some are saying it's the same virus will impact children uniformly like it did. What's your view on that? Is this going to be the next target of the virus, so to speak?
I mean, I think people are saying this from the history of pandemics. The logic is very simple, that the ones with the lowest immunity, which are the elders, get hit first with any viral disease and then any viral infection. It then moves on to the less, the ones with the, you know, with the little stronger immunity, which is the middle-aged, etc. And then it comes to the kids who tend to have the strongest immunity. And that's why usually it's in the kids will get hit the later part and not the earliest, right? And I think that's the reason why there is this theory about kids getting affected in the last part, because if the majority of elders and majority of working class people, 30 plus, have been infected or vaccinated, then the ones who are left are the children. So, I mean, there is a hypothesis around that. It's a logical hypothesis. And the question is really, what are we going to do to get ourselves ready for this? Because India cannot have a situation of dying children. It's just unacceptable.
And at the moment, I don't think you're ready for it. So hopefully we will be. Also, during the second wave, there was this strong theory that one of the reasons for the surge was a lot of false negative results by both public and private laboratories, right? So what was that the reason, or was it sample collection charge challenges, or was it the variant
your voice is again going in and out. It's very unclear.
Okay, hold on. Let me just switch to another network. Am I better now?
Yeah, slightly.
Is it better now?
Yeah, I think slightly better. No. No, not better, nothing better.
Okay, so there is a strong theory that went around. Okay, this should be better, I hope.
Let's hope so.
So I'm saying there was a strong theory that one of the reasons for the surge of the second wave was also a lot of false negative results by both public and private laboratories. So was that the case, or was it a lack of the India wave?
Or a lack of?
We couldn't detect the India variant, the testing?
See, you know, I think if you look at testing, there are many, many different components to this. And I'm glad you're asking this because there's so much of misinformation out there. So traditionally in molecular biology testing, you know, the way the machines work, The machines tend to be reasonably sensitive, and then it depends on the kind of chemicals that you use, the reagents that you use, that actually will pick up a certain level of virus in the DNA or the RNA, depending on the testing you're doing. And that specificity limit, what it's called, and the sensitivity limit is different for every machine and every reagent that you use. So number one, there is no standardized COVID PCR test. The result and the correctness and accuracy of the result will depend on the chemical, the equipment, and the person who's actually running the test, right? That's the first thing. Now, initially, when ICMR came out with an approval, they approved only 5 kits, which were all international kits, out of which there were 1 or 2 which were considered globally best. The others were considered sort of more second in line. And then ICMR expanded to provide more supply of reagents to many, many suppliers, and people started indigenously making these reagents as well. Now, if you actually see the cutoff for what ICMR used to approve these reagents, were the same, but what happened was that you got some reagents which were far more specific and some reagents which were far less specific, which means you were going to the same lab. If I ran, you know, one batch on certain reagents and the second batch on a different set of reagents, my positivity accuracy rate will be different. Okay. So what ended up happening was that good quality labs like ours chose to continue using globally best reagents. But because of a supply issue as well as of a choice issue, you found a various number of reagents being used all across public and private sector, often which is the cheapest. And there comes a lot of the reasons for the dichotomy in the results. That's number one. Number two, this virus is very, very finicky. So for example, Nitin, if you came to Metropolis today and I picked up a positive in your DNA, right, or RNA, and I gave you a positive result, and you said, oh, I don't know if I believe this positive result, and you go the next day and you go and get it done at another lab, it's very possible you will get a negative result and both are correct. And why do I say both are correct? Is because the virus has the ability to change its shape in terms of being detected within a matter of days. Now, how is that possible? Because the cutoff limit given by the WHO was 35, the CT value of 35, which basically means that if you got a CT value of 34, I have to give you as positive. If somebody else, another lab, gets a CT value of 36, they have to give it to you as negative. But both are borderline, right? And that means that you were actually already over your most positive phase and you are now, the virus was leaving your body. So we probably caught you on the last day of positivity and the next lab caught you on the first day of negativity. So, but because of this and because people don't understand this, there was a lot of misinformation about false positive, false negative, et cetera, et cetera. So this was point number two. But to answer your question, and there's a lot more technical detail, but to answer your question in short, yes, there have been a large number of false negatives in the system, a lot more because of the rats, because it's proven that the number of false negatives because of the rats, the rapid antigen tests are far, far, far higher than PCR. But even in the PCR, you do get 30-35% false negatives, even after using good quality reagents.
Okay. Several state governments also put price caps on tests from time to time, right? And they use, of course, the Epidemic Act to do that. So do you really think the quality of tests got compromised because of lower price challenges? Is that the case? And how are you guys coping with these constraints?
How are you?
Coping with these constraints with the price.
Yeah, I think it works slightly in a cat and mouse cycle. I wouldn't say that the quality of tests got compromised because of the pricing. It actually probably worked the other way around, which is that we had to keep the barrier in terms of, so one, India is a large country and very understandably, the Ministry of Health wanted to create a lot of supply in terms of chemicals and reagents that we are able to do testing all across the country. So they had to open up the supplier base and allow all kinds of companies to come in for allowing them for bringing in reagents. We get that, right? But because that came in and the cost of the reagent kept becoming cheaper and cheaper, some labs may have been more motivated as the prices kept falling, to look for the cheapest reagent rather than looking for the best quality reagent. Right. So if the price had been kept higher, probably that luxury of not looking for the cheapest one and therefore going for the best quality one would have been afforded to many more labs, right? Companies like us would not make that compromise at all, right? Because we follow global standards. But, you know, many of them don't, and therefore, you know, there becomes this choice that you have to make, which is unfortunate, which you don't want to make.
Fair enough. Tell me, a lot has also been written about the fact that the reporting on platforms like the ICMR portal and stuff was also a, you know, big time consumer. What can we do better there? Was that a big challenge itself?
No, I mean, it was a huge challenge. And frankly, I mean, the simplest way to do it in this automated technology-driven world today, it would have been for the public institutions to have IT integration with the private labs. So create an API, circulate it so that, the data entry is not being done. So let me tell you what actually used to happen. Let's say if a patient wanted to come to our lab, they have to first register, obviously, on the app. Then we have to take all the data on an SRF, which is almost 5 pages long, and put all of that data into the ICMR portal, right? And then when the results are ready, again, we have to put all that data into the ICMR portal. So we are actually doing a huge amount of manual entry. And all this has to be done before 24 hours. Now, even if you assume that there are zero technology glitches, which as we know in life never happens, sometimes electricity fails, power fails, connectivity fails, etc. The amount of effort it takes to fill in this data is so enormous that, just to give you an example, Metropolis alone has 100 people only doing this job, right? So a simple solution would be to create an API that allows for the data to be picked up from our systems and thrown by a bot into the ICMR portal and vice versa. And these kind of simple efficiencies would actually make life much easier and allow us to be more automated and efficient in the way we are working.
Right. So use technology better, basically.
Absolutely.
I just want to move directly a little bit around. I was going through the Rockefeller report on testing and tracing in India. The report also points out two or three things. One of the things that points out is that, I'm just going to go back to the pricing issue. One major reason is the pricing of test kits was fragmented procurement from central and state agencies, right? Without a commonly agreed upon price, a different price, etc. So if the country uses pooled procurement for RT-PCR kits, can be available, you know, more accurate testing can be done. Is that the right way to go about it?
Absolutely. I mean, like, for example, like the way procurement is being done with Pfizer and Moderna, saying that, look, central government will procure and allocate. Same thing could be done, you know, for example, if you believe company A, B, C are the best companies for reagents and give you the most specific results, do a global procurement for the country and allocate it. Let private states all buy from the government. That's absolutely fine. Very doable. I think that the challenge comes in two parts. I think the challenge comes first in intent. And I think somewhere in the initial days, there was almost a competition between states to say, look, who's got a lower negativity rate, right? And I think sometimes, therefore, the purpose of what we are trying to do, which is to find the most accurate result so we know the truth, may not necessarily be the most convenient answer, right? So I think that's, you know, the first point, right? And then the second point is about administratively bringing all the stakeholders on a common platform and saying, let's tackle this beast together, right? And I think, like I was referring to earlier, I think if we do that, we have a much better chance of actually solving many problems rather than what has been happening the last year, which is putting the problems on each other, right? You know, we want things to be more affordable, you know, push the private sector to do it cheaper. But push fine, but then how is it going to happen, right? I mean, I think if we work more collaboratively, I think there's a much better chance. For example, say, let's do national procurement, everybody gets cheaper prices, then automatically you can make it more affordable for consumers.
Absolutely. One of the other areas the report picks up on is innovation. Innovation and testing, use of varied testing technology has been a Netflix, Netflix in many parts of
the world. Answer you, Nathan.
I'm saying the innovation testing facilities in many parts of the world. Right? In India, while we were speaking of today's Sarawak-based test and others, our reliance is still on RT-PCR. How can we enhance innovation in testing?
You know, there have been so many new technologies that have come out. Just to give you a flavor of what they are, there are saliva-based tests, breath-based tests, you know, all across the world, some of them which have been tried and tested in different parts of the country. There are samples in the US, for example, you self take a sample and you ship it in. Now look, some things that work in other countries may not work in India. In India, there has been a huge taboo around corona initially. And even now there tends to be a concern around if you're found positive and what is the reaction of that. I would say less in cities now, but it was in cities even a year ago. But now in the towns and villages, it still continues to be a big concern point because it means you can't go to work. You know, you lose your 15 days or 20 days of minimum wage if you're a daily laborer. So often it's highly inconvenient for people to be found corona positive. So trusting that people are going to take the sample properly and ship it in, you know, I'm not sure whether that really is suitable for India. So I don't think we can copy paste some of the things that have happened everywhere else and just put them onto our population, which may not be as educated, you know, as others. And therefore, I think, but I do think that the rats, for example, while they have do give faster reports, they do land up in a lot of ways because of the amount of false negativity you get from it. It possibly does land up giving you a false impression of what your health is. In that short run, which means if you are positive, you continue to spread it. So I think there are things that we can discontinue if we choose to. And you know, building up capacity of PCR is not a huge challenge as long as you have some collaboration in future prediction. So for example, sitting here today, if government and private sector come together and say, look, our mathematical models show that in the third wave, this is what we are potentially expecting. Based on trends and history, this is where it will start, this is where it will spread. We urge you to build up your capacity to X. And as a government asking you to do this, we will help you in 1, 2, 3 way, right? And I tell you, private sector will be happy to do that and make that investment.
Fair enough. I'm going to move to another section, which is on more non-COVID. While we've spoken a lot of COVID, but I think there's also this huge gap which is increasing where patients are not going for their, you know, existing ailments, right? So what's your view on that? How do we now get patients back into labs for their regular testing, their annual testing or 6 month testing they do, or back into hospitals for treatment of their existing ailments?
I mean, honestly, this is the biggest concern area for India, if you ask me, going forward, right? Because so many infections, diseases, underlying conditions have been just ignored or swept under the carpet over the last 1 year, whether it's elective surgeries that have been delayed or, you know, even people just, you know, cancer patients, dialysis patients not being able to get their regular care. That is really scary because the kind of health situations, it's probably going to come back to bite us over the next few years for something that is so neglected over 1 year is going to really probably hurt us as a Indian citizenship, Indian citizen community for a while. I think the only way we can honestly urge is one against education and talking about people, you know, going back. Number two, the actual experience of engaging with healthcare community to make it safe. So like for example, the first thing that has to be done, like I know the government very smartly opened up the vaccination program for healthcare workers early in February and March. Unfortunately, at that point of time, even healthcare workers believed that everything is now okay and normal and we don't, you know, corona's gone away. And most did not take their vaccinations. So even today, you have a large amount of healthcare workers who are unvaccinated. But unfortunately, now there are no vaccines, so they can't get vaccinated when they want to. So the first thing I would do is honestly, when we open up and we get vaccines, to get our healthcare industry completely vaccinated would be the first step, right? Because if the healthcare industry is vaccinated, patients also will feel more comfortable engaging with the healthcare community, knowing that, you know, that's a safer group to interact with and people will start coming back for their normal issues.
Yeah. Okay. So that was the non-COVID part. So, you know, just going towards the more industry, some of the industry issues, there is still a shortage of quality diagnostic labs in India, right? So how can the, what are the steps the government needs to take in this regard to, you know, enhance or scale up the good quality of the accredited labs in India? And are there any steps that are already underway for this?
I mean, honestly, it's very simple to do. It's not difficult. I mean, I think the first thing to do is to create some very basic minimum standards for the industry. Today, nobody knows how many labs we have in the country, which is a very scary thought that you know, anybody can operate. So first thing is to register, create a minimum standard that people have to follow, to actually process and work as a laboratory. And then number three, create a proficiency testing program, which means that, you're sending samples to these labs every month. They are doing the test and sending you the results, and you are able to check whether they have actually matched the quality standards or not, right? So there are very simple, these are things which are happening across the world. Besides obviously audits and going and auditing their facilities, like in the US, every year a lab has to get audited for them to continue and to renew their license, right? So I think there are some very basic things that can be done to upgrade the lab quality. And if you again look at other countries, and when this happens, the natural consequence of minimum standards is that a lot of the players or the unorganized labs, which are completely blatantly not following quality norms, will either have two choices. Either they step up, they make those investments and they become more quality conscious, or they'll have to perish. And in that bargain, what emerges is a better quality of network that patients can then trust, doctors can then trust, and overall the confidence of the healthcare industry builds. Unfortunately, today there is such a mistrust that has been created between government, private, and the consumer that it's really unhealthy for everybody, because in a space that operates on the fundamental basis of trust, if you don't have trust between the three most important stakeholders, it's a very challenging place to then evolve and become more innovative.
I have to say it's amazing. I remember 10 years ago in your office in Bombay, we had the same discussion about...
Isn't that sad?
That about accreditation and how accreditation is not becoming important in labs, etc. So it's amazing 10 years later, we're having the same discussion. Well, tell me, where does India stand? I mean, the government is talking a lot about Atmanirbhar, etc. Where do we currently stand on the Atmanirbhar quotient in terms of diagnostic equipment and technology? You know, considering, you know, we have to scale up now much more than ever in the past.
Look, I mean, if you take the top 100 healthcare providers in India, be it labs, be it hospitals, dialysis center, cancer centers, any of them, unfortunately, you will find maybe 70 to 80% of all medical technology use being imported, right? And the reason for that is very simple, that the global players have managed to build some serious IP, good quality and very robust machines, which have passed through US FDA, CE approval, et cetera. So there is this trust and a sense of quality that comes with it. And even though they tend to be more expensive, the top 100 healthcare institutions will put quality over cost and prioritize that for sure. There are indigenous companies that do make sonographies and x-rays and lab instruments and, you know, chemicals and all kinds of stuff. But, I don't think we see necessarily that same global parity in terms of full quality. And I'm speaking generally, there are of course exceptions to that rule. But generally, we haven't seen it come up to that level yet. And this requires huge amount of research investment because, you know, you can't just expect that there's going to be a hungry spirit that's suddenly going to go and build this, because these companies, global companies that have made it after years and years of investment and research. And that if we don't support in India, it's unlikely that even in the next 5 years, we will see a very booming indigenous industry.
So what do we need, more government support in terms of subsidies or promoting R&D in India?
Actually, I would say more than subsidies, I think you just need policies. You know, if there was a policy made, for example, you know, I mean, number one is ease of doing business. I think that is a general area for all industries. But I think number two, for example, if you created something as simple as a tax holiday, like you created for the IT firms, you know, because they were exporting in large amounts, create a tax holiday for firms that are, you know, basing their medtech on research and development. And companies who are getting a CE approval or a US FDA approval, for example, you know, there are certain things you can do to motivate and you know, allow those hungry spirits and animal spirits to really flourish. We do have good entrepreneurship, and then provide credit lines if needed from a government support standpoint. And frankly, if you do that and there's some ease of doing business, because that's the biggest challenge, and more importantly, a comfort and an assurance that suddenly the government's not going to come in and start capping prices or start retrospectively taxing or start changing any policy that's going to change the fundamentals of the business plan. One of the biggest worries in healthcare that most institutions have today is that, look, if people make investments into building something and that investment has to pay over 5 years or 10 years, and in that 10-year period, how many times if the policy changes, how do we build anything? I think just that simple assurance of having a steady policy, you know, with no changes in the middle, I think itself would do the job.
You know, that brings me to my next question, which is, how does the private sector work more closely and better with the government, or the government work better with the private sector? Because you alluded to this earlier in the conversation, that the government must take private sector into confidence and come up with strategy with them. So, you know, is there a national task force we need which includes both the public and private sector working together, something like that?
Absolutely. I mean, I think a task force would be a great idea. And more importantly than the task force, I think it has to be an empowered task force that actually has the ear of whoever the decision maker is. You know, we've seen even during COVID a bunch of task force come about. And some of them have had private players on them. But the way of choosing sometimes the private players, sometimes the way of constructing these task forces, how empowered they are, is anybody really listening? I think those are the more important questions that have to be faced, you know, because, you know, creating committees which nobody's listening to, I think may not be that helpful.
Fair enough. Tell me, trust has been a big part of, you know, consumers, with whether it's hospitals or labs, etc. Trust has increased or become better in the last during COVID. Patients are going more to hospitals. They're looking more towards hospitals to treat them better. And how can we create better trust from consumers and the private sector?
See, I think trust comes from experience, right? And I think if you look at it from a consumer standpoint, you know, today there is no patient charter, for example. Patient doesn't know their rights. What are the rights of a patient? I think that's a question mark that we need to answer. I think as an industry, you know, we are also partly at fault because there is, and that again goes back to policy, there is such a wide variety of levels of quality in the private sector that again, we can't bunch all private sector together. You know, you've got to segment them and say, look, who are the guys who are actually following the rules? Who are the guys who are not following the rules? Unfortunately, when public sector looks at us or when consumers look at us, they look at us as one bunch. So you have even one bad apple or five bad apples and it messes up the entire industry's reputation. So I think the experience of the patient is critical. Now, I think for that, you need transparent pricing. A patient, when they walk in, should know what they're going to pay. You know, is that easy to do? It's tough to do, especially for hospitals, because sometimes things evolve once the patient is in there. But how we can get to some method of transparent pricing, I think is going to be a big part of trust building. You know, how we can get to a good place of communication with government, like I said, and segment and self-regulate our industries is going to be a big important part of trust building. And I think putting, like I said, a patient charter so they know that, look, they have their rights, they have a place to go to if, you know, a provider doesn't meet the basic requirements. I think these are some of the things that could help build the trust.
Okay. We also talked about this earlier, which is about how COVID is now spread to some you know, rural parts of India.
Yeah.
How do we address that? How do we address the urban divide in this market from a diagnostic testing perspective, as well as I guess healthcare services perspective?
See, setting up a lab facility in a state in rural parts of the country. So let's take a state, any state like Orissa, or let's take UP, or let's take Bihar, Jharkhand, which may have lesser testing facilities compared to Maharashtra or Tamil Nadu or Delhi. And in these markets, you will find in the capital cities, there are, some state labs which are doing testing, but probably the capacity, the throughput, the trained people, etc., are all depending on how much the state government has actually put energy or effort into it, right? Private sector will have minimum labs and minimum throughput in these markets. If you go deeper, you'll find an even scarier situation where probably states don't even have labs, state governments don't have labs, and private sector is non-existent. Now, if you try to collect samples from these locations and bring it back to Delhi, right, your report is not going to go for 2 days, 3 days. So I think that model doesn't necessarily work. The model that works is to actually get into a public-private partnership with private players and ask them to come and set up labs in the state, right? In, let's say, capital cities, top 5, 6, 7 top cities of the state, right? Build throughput. And number two, organize mobile vans, which can be used to go and collect samples from the rural markets or the districts in a very efficient logistical plan. And in that format, you are going to be able to get reports within 24 hours in most places, right? Now, why would private sector go and do this initiative? And let me tell you, private sector is very capable of doing this. But for private sector to go and do this, knowing that COVID comes in waves of 1 month, 2 months, and then goes away and comes again later for 1 month, 2 months, private sector and public have to have an understanding that, look, this has to be a profitable enterprise for private sector. And therefore, let's make sure we are giving assured volumes. We are letting private sector make a profit. As long as our people get tested, we should be happy, right? As long as nobody's allowing the private sector to make a 40% margin on it, please let them make a 10% margin on it. But it's important they make a margin. Otherwise, why are they going to do it?
Yeah, fair enough. We've got a couple of more questions coming in. Will RT-PCR test be as effective against the new virus?
Good question. look, the kits and the reagents are constantly evolving. So I think the current variant of the B.1.617, I think, has already been detected through the current range of PCR kits. So I don't think there's anything significant to worry about. And I think the good news, if we look at actually how viruses work, while we may know about the current variant, at any point of time, there are multiple virus variants circulating. And the way viruses work is that the one that emerges is actually the one that has beaten all the other virus variants, right? And those have therefore died because it's survival of the fittest amongst the viruses, right? So like last year, we had again 4.5, and the N440K was the one which was the most lethal variant, and it was spreading. Then the B.1.617 came and said, oh, you 440, I'm going to kick you on the butt and throw you out. And it managed to throw that variant out. And it became the emerging variant, right? So the good news is that as this evolution happens, we have time to keep researching, because the variants don't suddenly pop out of anywhere. They are actually there in the system for a while. So it gives us a chance to actually research and build chemicals and kits that are able to address new variants as
well. Okay. That's good to know that at least most variants will at some stage get detected in. At least the old ones are dying. So that's
dying or circulating less.
Or circulating less, yeah. So another question is coming. Some states like Jharkhand or Kerala have given us good lessons around testing and tracing. Are there ways to replicate it in other geographies?
I think it's very interesting to look at why Kerala has succeeded. And I think one of the reasons, and the same reason why Vietnam, by the way, succeeded, is the kind of infrastructure and investment they made in public healthcare much before the pandemic. So if you look at Vietnam, for example, and come to Kerala, when they had the other viruses in Asia in 2000, 2009, 2008, 2009, and even before that, what they did was they actually built micro centers of disease control in every district of Vietnam. And what these micro centers of disease control would do is they would actually even take something like the flu or tuberculosis or malaria or dengue, whatever, and would do testing and tracing for even those viruses. So they actually created public health facilities, which actually their full-time job was to actually go and test and trace for any infectious disease. Now, when you build that kind of institution, they become experts through experience of knowing how to test and trace. What we are doing in India today is we are expecting our municipal corporations to do the same job of public health experts. And hats off to the municipal corporations, but they don't know how. They've had to learn, right? So the concept of testing and tracing itself is new in India, and we are expecting non-public health experts to do it, which is why it's taking us such a long time to learn. Kerala, on the other hand, with the kind of investment in education and health that they have done for years together, was much stronger on the public health institutions than most of the other states in the country. And that's the reason why they have succeeded.
Interesting. So it comes down to, I guess, education and...
experience and readiness.
And readiness. Tell me the other thing that's come out a lot, technology. How do we use technology to treat people better across the country, especially rurally? You talked about mobile vans and setting up centers, but what about actual treatment and healthcare centers being set up?
Look, I mean, it's going to be very tough, right? And this is where we're going to have to rely very heavily on the public sector, because private sector really doesn't play that active a role in the smaller towns and markets. Some part of our private sector does, but clearly that's not a regulated part as we know, and therefore it's very difficult to know what is the kind of treatment being given out or whether it's standardized at all. I would say that, you know, the more central policies and protocols that we can come out with in terms of treatment would be very helpful. Like, one of the things I've seen as a comparison between the US and India, in the US, for example, when the CDC comes out with a protocol for treatment, that gets sent through insurance companies and through hospital systems, and all people start following the same protocol, right? So when do you give toxi? When do you give steroid? When do you, you know, give remdesivir? Do you not? You know, when do you need a ventilator, OC, etc., etc.? In India, every doctor is their own magician, and every doctor has created their own protocol from their own experience of how to treat COVID, right? So if you land up going to a good doctor who's got good experience and specialization, you're lucky. But if you land up going to a doctor who doesn't have that experience in COVID,
God help you.
So if I think if our government can spend, and they have come out, ICMR has come out with some protocols, I think if we can spend more time in detailing these out, spreading information about them through IMAs and through other organizations, again, who have got doctors all over the country. If we can use telemedicine in a smart way to be able to use our experienced doctors in cities who have treated COVID for the last 1 year and use them to find a way to treat rural India patients rather than the new doctors in rural India learning now how to treat COVID. This game is all about picking up the resources which are currently unutilized and using them for places where the COVID is. And how do you bring the two together? And that's what technology creates, that gap, and fills that gap with the bridge.
Got it. Tony, do you think where countries like India, where testing and health has been a challenge in the past, people are more comfortable testing with COVID, I mean, the silver lining in a way, and they will not change the way they look at preventive health checks and tests for other diseases as well? Do you think that will change?
You said, are people more comfortable testing for COVID?
Will they become more comfortable post-COVID to test for non-communicable diseases?
Look, I don't think people will be testing for people will be doing their preventive health care and wellness. I think definitely health has come more to the fore. Suddenly people are more aware of their health and thinking about it. They want to be more conscious. What has become more careful, people have become more careful, is wanting to go to branded standardized players where they think that there is a trust on, you know, what they can get out of it. So I think Overall, I think there will be a move to better health management. There will be a move to better quality players, you know, hopefully that will help the patients in the longer term. But you know, we are also in a stage in India where sometimes we forget easily, and I just hope that this time we don't. You know, and we keep this in the, sort of in the forefront of our minds on how important health has been and needs to be from even from an immunity standpoint.
Enough. Okay, we're coming to the end of our session. So my last question really is, would you change anything you did during the pandemic? Would you do anything differently? Would you do the same thing again?
Look, I mean, I think the pandemic has been such a challenge for so many people that I think there are a list of things we could all do differently. Definitely I would say there are a couple that I would do differently. But I'll just share with you what I'm happy that we did, and I'll share with you a couple of what we could have done differently. So we came out with a program called Healthcare Heroes, where we've actually used our CSR funds as a platform to recognize all the frontline workers that have actually done really good work across the country. We accepted nominations for people and we're in the process of recognizing them. So I'm very happy about us having the time and the bandwidth to be able to create this program to recognize frontline healthcare workers from Metropolis. So I'm happy about that. What I would do differently is I wish this program we could have launched earlier in the year, because I think where you need recognition and motivation for individuals, you know, during the process of stress, and I think that's, I wish the timing could have been earlier. That's definitely one. And I think second, I think often in healthcare, you know, all of us have been in the middle of crisis situations, handling things on a daily basis. And as much as we've tried to take care of our people, and we have about almost 4,500 people in Metropolis, I wish I had the ability to reach out to them, each of them regularly, and say, look, how are you doing? I haven't had the bandwidth for that, but I wish.
Great. Thank you, Mias, today. That's all we have for you today. Thank you.
Thanks, Nitin. Good to chat with you.